Good morning, children. Welcome to our online Sunday school. Hope you all are doing good.
Children, let's watch an interaction between a Christian mother and her unbaptized 7-year-old daughter.
Mama, why those who are not baptized can't receive communion?
Because they don't believe that Jesus is really present there in the host.
I believe, but I am not baptized. Why can't I receive communion?
Because you're not baptized, and so you're not a Christian.
I'm sure if my friends of other faith or anyone went to Jesus, he would not send them away.
The problem is wider than the first Holy Communion of children. I have difficulty sometimes understanding the oneness aspect of the Eucharist in my life. My husband from other faith and I are joined before Christ, but he is not admissible to the communion table, even if he experiences a belief in the real presence. Can it be Christ's will for us to be united in the most intimate way at one level, only to be divided at the Eucharist, which we actually call the sacrament of unity? I wonder.
Children, what do you think? Should the church permit those not baptized to receive Holy Communion? Why or why not? This problem is a major issue arising in mixed marriages as well as in many of our churches where people of other faiths desire to receive communion. Some see nothing wrong in allowing them to receive. Others think it is improper. How do we solve this problem in the church? A similar problem existed in the early church. Peter ate a meal in the house of a Gentile. Gentile is a term given to non-Jews who were considered unclean because they worshipped idols, ate food that were offered to idols, and generally lived a lifestyle of adultery and fornication. Why did Peter break the Jewish law and do that? Then the major issue was, should the gospel be preached to non-Jews, that is the Gentiles? Can they be baptized, and more so, if they are baptized, must they become Jews first? That is, must they be circumcised and brought under the Mosaic law? These questions engaged the early church in sorting out the matter. Peter, while on a pastoral visit to all the churches along coastal Palestine, works two great miracles that bring out his importance and sets the scene for his role in the conversion of the first Gentiles and preaching the gospel to them. Aeneas, a paralytic bedridden for 8 years, is simply told by Peter that Jesus Christ has healed him and that he can get up and fold up his bed. The man got up at once. This led to the inhabitants of the town Lydda to become Christians. This story reminds us of the paralytic healed by Jesus at Bethsaida. In the neighboring town of Joppa, a woman convert named Tabitha or Dorcas, whose life was marked by constant good deeds and acts of charity, suddenly fell ill and died. Peter was called to Joppa and told of the extreme goodness of that lady. He made everyone leave the room, knelt down and prayed, then said to the woman, "Tabitha, stand up." And immediately the woman got up. These two stories draw a parallel to the Gospel of Luke, chapter 7, verses 1 to 17, which also describes two back-to-back miracle stories about the healing of a centurion's servant and the raising of a widow's son. Thus, Luke stresses the church's mission of continuing the work of healing and preaching the good news, which was the work started by Jesus. These signs accompanied the preaching of the gospel and affirmed the authority of the apostles. Judaism introduced the world to monotheism, the worship of the one true God. People who were weary of many gods and the loose morals of their nations found the one God and strict moral standards of Judaism very attractive. It gave life meaning. If they accepted Judaism, came under the Mosaic law, and were circumcised, they were called proselytes. If they did not go that far, but continued to attend the synagogue, read the Jewish scriptures, and led a God-fearing life, they were called God-fearers. Cornelius, a centurion stationed at Caesarea, the headquarters of the government of Palestine, was one such God-fearer. He, along with his family. Cornelius, a very devout man, very regular in prayer, at about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, had a vision of an angel. The angel instructed him to send men to Joppa and summon a man named Simon, who is also called Peter, and bring him to Caesarea. Cornelius sent two of his servants and a very devout soldier from his garrison to do what the angel had instructed. The angel had given very clear instructions as to where they were to locate Peter. The next day, Peter was praying on the rooftop. He was very hungry. In a vision, he sees the sky open and an object come down that looked like a big canvas. Inside it were all types of creatures. A voice said to him, "Get up, Peter, slaughter and eat." Peter refused because he had always remained faithful to the law and had never eaten anything unclean all his life. The voice rejected his refusal, saying, "What God had purified, you are not to call unclean." This was repeated 3 times, and then the object was pulled back into the sky. Meanwhile, the 3 men sent by Cornelius arrived. Peter was told by the Spirit to go downstairs and set out with them unhesitatingly, for it was God who sent them. After inviting them in and treating them well, Peter went with them to Caesarea. These 2 visions prepared the groundwork for Peter's realization that no one can regard anything that God has made clean as something that can defile them. It opens the way to acceptance to all kinds of food and invites the church to accept all types of people from any race or culture. Later, on the Council of Jerusalem will declare, God made no distinction between us and them, that is the Gentiles, but purified their hearts by faith. Peter uses Deuteronomy chapter 10 verses 17. God shows no partiality as the basis for his argument in favor of accepting the Gentiles into the church. God is not an unjust judge in every nation. The one who fears God and acts uprightly is acceptable to him. Peter then proceeds to give the Gentiles a summary of the Christian preaching on Christ, explaining that he is Lord for all, Jews as well as Gentiles. Peter specially focuses on the apostles as the true witnesses and their mandate to preach to the people. While they are hearing God's word, the Holy Spirit comes upon the Gentiles. Luke brings out the similarity with the first Pentecost, amazement, speaking in tongues, glorifying God, etc. The amazement is all the more since they are Gentiles. The gift of the Holy Spirit has been poured out even on Gentiles. They exclaim. Peter replies, they have received the Holy Spirit as we did. Can anyone forbid water for baptizing these people? The vision now becomes clearer to Peter. What God has cleansed, no one can declare unclean. Thus, Cornelius and his whole household are baptized. When the news of the happenings at Caesarea reached the church in Judea, they were greatly disturbed. They questioned Peter, "Why did you enter the house of the uncircumcised and eat with them?" Peter then explains to them his vision and its significance, stressing that the Holy Spirit had instructed him to accompany these men to Caesarea and make no distinction. He tells them of the happenings there and how the Gentiles too received the Holy Spirit. He then concludes, "If then God gave the same gift as he gave to us, who am I that I could withstand God?" With this, the people were convinced and glorified God. After the question of admitting Gentiles is resolved, Luke continues to describe the early church's outreach to Antioch. Antioch in northern Syria, on the Mediterranean coast, was the third largest city after Rome and Alexandria. The reason for the birth of the church in Antioch was the persecution in Jerusalem. The Christians fled, some to Antioch and others across the sea to Cyprus, the homeland of Barnabas. Barnabas, whose name means son of encouragement, is sent by the Jerusalem church to take care of the community in Antioch. True to his name, he encouraged them all to remain faithful in their commitment to the Lord. When there was a famine all over the land, the church in Antioch had concern for their mother church in Judea, and they set something aside, each according to their means, and sent it to their brethren in Judea. Major issues broke out in the early church on dealing and mixing with Gentiles or non-Jews. Peter had a meal with Gentiles, which was forbidden by Mosaic law. The question whether Gentiles can be admitted to Christianity, and if so, then must they observe Jewish laws? The main question, whether Gentile Christians must first be circumcised, that is made Jews first, and then baptized? The question of eating clean and unclean food. All these questions centered on strict observance of the law given through Moses. Must the church still observe the Mosaic laws? These were major issues that affected Orthodox Jewish Christians very deeply. Disobedience to the law meant disobedience to God. So how do they resolve this conflict? The early church set the trend of what the church always does to resolve serious conflicts. The matter is taken to the apostles or elders. It is not one man who decides alone. This is called the principle of collegiality. All the elders and apostles seriously discuss and debate the issue. They together pray, relying on the light of the Holy Spirit. Fast, a sign of their own commitment and sacrifice. Debate and discuss, to let all issues and feelings surface, and finally rely on the final authority of the head of the church, that is the bishop or pope, who is also in tune with the guidance of the Holy Spirit that emerges through collegiality. The voices and feelings of his fellow bishops or elders. This collegiality has been the tradition of the church since the time of the apostles. That is why the church has had many councils and synods. Even the local church, the diocese, calls up a synod to discuss issues and give the church a direction. One such synod was held at Mumbai in January 2001. There was one scheduled in 2020, but was postponed because of the pandemic. Children, take a comfortable posture. Breathe in, breathe out. Breathe in, breathe out. Place your palms on the lap, facing upwards. Breathe in, breathe out, and gently close your eyes and pay attention to the reading, a reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Now, the apostles and the brethren who were in Judea heard that the Gentiles also had received the word of God. So when Peter went up to Jerusalem, the circumcision party criticized him, saying, "Why did you go to uncircumcised men and eat with them?" But Peter began from the beginning and explained to them in order. I was in the city of Joppa praying, and in a trance I saw a vision, something descending like a great sheet let down from heaven by four corners, and it came down to me. Looking at it closely, I observed animals and beasts of prey and reptiles and birds of the air. And I heard a voice saying to me, "Rise, Peter, kill and eat." But I said, "No, Lord, for nothing common or unclean has ever entered my mouth." But the voice answered a second time from heaven, "What God has cleansed, you must not call common." This happened three times, and all was drawn up again into heaven. At that very moment, three men arrived at the house in which we were sent to me from Caesarea. And the Spirit told me to go with them, making no distinction. These six brethren also accompanied me, and we entered the man's house. And he told us how he had seen the angel standing in his house and saying, "Send to Joppa and bring Simon called Peter. He will declare to you a message by which you will be saved, you and all your household." As I began to speak, the Holy Spirit fell on them just as on us at the beginning. And I remembered the word of the Lord, how he said, "John baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit." If then God gave the same gift to them as he gave to us when we believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could withstand God? When they heard this, they were silenced, and they glorified God, saying, "Then to the Gentiles also God has granted repentance unto life." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. What was the problem brought up by the circumcision party? What is that made Peter think differently? How do you think the circumcision party must have felt when they heard Peter's decision? The early Christians had to deal with a major problem that arose amongst them. They dealt with those problems through discussion and debate, that is, through listening and speaking, and relying on the final authority of the apostles. Children, pray that when we too have problems, We may not fight and quarrel, but try to solve our problems through discussion as well as listening to people in authority. Now gently open your eyes and let's sing a hymn. Come Holy Spirit, we need thee. Let us sign ourselves in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Children, it's time for your activity. You are going to write a letter to the mother whose interaction we saw in the beginning of the class by using the incident from the Acts of the Apostles to explain the below points, that the church wants to reach out in love to all the unbaptized and that the church reserves the Eucharist only to those who are baptized, and send it to your Sunday school teacher. Thank you, dear children. May God bless you. Take care. Stay healthy. Stay home. Stay safe. Bye-bye.